Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the first official video in the ESP32 series using the ESP-IDF, and we will start this series with UART. I have also made a video last time covering UART in ESP32, so think of this video as an updated version of the previous one. In the previous video of the ESP32 series, we saw how to install the IDE, and how to run the first Blink project. So now we will cover the first peripheral in ESP32, and that is UART. I will cover the UART in two parts. In the first part, we will create the project from the given examples, and I will explain how the entire project works. In the next video, that is the second part, we will make it a little more practical, where we will control the LED connected to the ESP32, via the UART. So let's start the Expressive IDE, and create a new Expressive IDF project. I am using the ESP32 Room Development Board. We will create the project using the examples, so check this box. Now scroll down to Peripherals, then expand the UART section. Here we have different UART examples, but we will go with the first one, UART Asynchronous RxTx Tasks. This one is easier and more practical to understand, and basically this is all we need for the UART to work. When we have a little more complicated requirement, we will modify this code to fit the scenario. Let's rename the project to UART Part 1, and click Finish. Alright, our project has been created, let's first build it once. The build is successful, and we do not have any errors here. Let's understand how this works now. In the main function, there is a call to the initialization function. This function initializes the UART driver. Then the RX and TX tasks are being created, with the priority of the RX task being higher than the TX task. The RX task is used to receive the data via the UART, and TX task will transmit the data every 2 seconds. Let's see the initialization function. Here we first create the UART configuration, with the baud rate of 11,5200, 8 data bits, no parity, and 1 stop bit. This is the standard configuration, 11,5200, 8N1. The hardware flow control is disabled, and the source clock is set to default, which is the APB clock. Then the function UART driver install is called to install the driver. The parameters of this function are the UART number, which is the UART instance being used, the RX and TX buffer sizes, the queue size and its handle if the queue is being used, and at last the interrupt flags. We are not using the TX buffer, but the RX buffer size has a limitation on the minimum value. If you take a look at this statement here, the driver will fail if this condition is not satisfied. The RX buffer length should be more than the hardware FIFO length, which is defined as 128 bytes in the SoC caps header file. So the RX buffer length should be at least 129 bytes. But if you note here, the value being passed in the parameter is being multiplied by 2. So this means, the minimum value I can define here is 65, which will make the final value in the parameter as 130. I might receive bigger data, so I am defining 128 here. This makes our RX buffer size equal to 256 bytes. The first parameter in the driver install function is the UART number. Each ESP32 development board might have one or more UART instances, you just need to verify with the board's datasheet. For example, this 38-pin board I am using has 3 UARTs available, so we have 3 instances. Here you can see the pins available for these 3 UARTs. The naming convention starts from UART 0, so we have 0, 1, and 2. As I mentioned in the previous video, the UART 0 is used by the terminal, we need this terminal to see the logs, so I will leave UART 0. We now have UART 1, and UART 2 available for communication. The next parameter is RX buffer size, which I have already explained. Then the TX buffer size is set to 0, as we are not using any buffer for TX. The queue and interrupts are also not being used, so they are also set to 0. The next function is used to configure the UART, and here we pass the UART configuration created above. Then the setPin function is used to set the pins used by the UART. The TX and RX pins are defined above. These can change based on which UART instance you are using. Since there is no hardware flow control, the RTs and CTS pins are set to no change. To make things simpler, let's define the UART num, where we will input the UART instance that we will be using. I am going to use the UART2. The pin number 16 is the RX pin and pin 17 is the TX pin for the UART2. Let's change the pins in the definition. Now change the UARTNUM1 to the UARTNUM. Alright, our initialization function is complete, and now we will take a look at the TX task. The TX task is used to send the data via the UART. Here first the TX tag is defined, which is then used to set the log level for the same. Inside the while loop, we call the function sendData, and pass the data hello world to it. Let me add the new line character at the end of this data. This loop runs every 2 seconds, so that's the delay in which we will see data on the serial console. Inside the sendData function we first calculate the length of the data to be sent. The function uartSendBytes is used to send the data. The parameters of this function are the uart instance, the source data buffer which contains the data, and the size of the data to be sent. After sending the data, the log is being recorded, which contains how many bytes has been sent via the UART. The UART send bytes returns the number of bytes successfully sent, and this data is stored in the TX bytes variable. This variable is then passed to the ESP log. So basically the TX task will send the data every 2 seconds, and records the log of how many data bytes were sent. Let's see the RX task now. In the beginning we again have the tag for the RX task, and then the same information log level is set for it. Then we allocate the memory for the RX buffer, whose size is 1 more than the size defined in the beginning. Inside the while loop, we call the function uartReadBytes to receive the data from the UART. The parameters of this function are the UART instance, the buffer where the received data will be stored, the size of the buffer, and the timeout in milliseconds, in case the required amount of data has not been received. Even if the required amount of data is not received, the received data is stored in the past buffer, so we can still process it. This function returns the number of bytes received, and it is stored in the variable RXBytes. So if we receive even a single byte, the RXByte variable will be greater than 0, and then we can process the received data. Here we will first write a 0 to the end of the RX buffer. This is used to terminate the received data string. And since we are adding this extra byte to the received data, we defined the RX buffer with 1 extra byte than the RX buffer length defined in the beginning. Then the received data is logged into the terminal. And this function is used to dump the hexadecimal values for the equivalent characters in the RX data buffer. We will see them in the runtime. So that's all there is in this code. Let's take a look at the connection now. I am using AFT232 USB to TTL converter, which is connected between the computer and the ESP32 board. The UART connection is always in cross, so connect the TX pin from the ESP32 with the RX pin of the FT232, and vice versa. Let's open the serial console on the computer. I am using this WCH serial port software on my Mac. You can get it from the App Store itself. Or you can download some other serial console as per your requirement. Make sure the correct serial port is selected. The USB serial 0001 is for the ESP32 board, and the other one is for the FT232 module. The UART configuration should be the same as what we set in the program. The baud rate is 115200, there should be 8 data bits, no hardware flow control, 1 stop bit, and no parity. Click Connect to open the serial port. Now we will flash the project to the ESP32, but before that, make sure the target configuration is correct. Let's flash the project to the board. Alright, let's open the terminal, so that we can see the logs. You can see the log for the TX task, which is sending 12 bytes of data every 2 seconds. We can see the data sent by the TX task in the serial console. It is being received every 2 seconds. Now we will send the data from the computer to the ESP32. Here you can see the data was received and then logged into the terminal. And below the data, you can see the output of the hex dump function. Let's send some other data to the ESP32. We have received the data in the ESP32. You might have noticed that the reception takes quite some time, and that is because the timeout is set to 1 second. Basically, this function waits for 1 second to receive the data before it timeout. We will modify it to reduce the latency. We don't really need to log the TX task, so let's remove this. Also remove this send data function form here, instead we will directly send the data at this point. Outside the while loop, let's allocate 30 bytes to store the TX data. Also define the integer num, whose value will be transmitted via the UART. Inside the while loop, first prepare the data to be transmitted. The sprintf function is used to convert the decimal value of the num integer to the string format, and this string is stored in the data array. Also, we will update the num variable, so that we have a new value each time. Typecast this to the character pointer. Now call the function uartWriteBytes to send the data buffer to the UART. The size of the buffer is the return value of the sprintf function. I want the data to be transmitted every 1 second. We don't need the sendData function anymore, so let's delete it now. Let's also remove the hex dump function from the RX task, and reduce the timeout to 200 milliseconds. If you reduce the timeout to a very small value, you will get the data instantly, but you might miss some of the data. So the value chosen for the timeout is a compromise between the reception latency, and the receiving complete data. We forgot to free the allocated memory for the TX data buffer in the TX task. Alright, our code is ready, let's build it once. There are no errors, so let's flash it to the board. Let me add the new line character at the end of this string. You can see the hello world is printing every second, with the updated value of the num variable. Let's send some data to the board. The data is being logged into the terminal. Also note that the data latency has been reduced quite a lot. It is not instantaneous, but it is still fine. So we are able to use the UART to transmit and receive data from the computer. In the next video, we will make use of this received data and controller LED using the commands from the computer. We will also limit the execution of the TX task so that it does not run periodically. This is it for the video. I hope you understood how to use the simple UART to transmit and receive the data. You can download the code from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.